of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind. Still you hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. That calm the sea would call out through the rain and calm the storm in me. Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done. Not because of what I've done, but because of who you are.
Please be seated. Who do you belong to? Whose are we? We are His. He knows us by name. He celebrates because we are here this morning in worship and in praise unto Him. It is amazing to know that God is in His place with us. The Lord Jesus Christ is here. The Holy Spirit is here because we are here. We are the children of the Lord God Almighty. And that we celebrate in praise and in worship. Please join me in the call to worship. The Lord is the light of our strength. The Lord is the stronghold of our lives.
Whom shall we be afraid?
Trust in the Lord at all times. Teach us your ways, Almighty God. Remind us daily that you are the only true God.
Amen.
that we always call upon the Lamb God. Please join in the prayer of confession. When temptation whispers, we want to answer that call. We long to be powerful. We want to be all-knowing. We long to be in control. We want things our own way. Compassionate God, give us courage to admit our failings. Teach us to speak truth. Keep us from any deceit. Transform our hearts by the power of your grace, that we may accept your forgiveness and live with joy and the life that you have planned for us. Amen. Holy Spirit, come into our hearts. Bring the words that are written in the Scripture alive to our hearts, for they are powerful and they are mighty. We thank you, Lord, for listening to our prayer before you. We thank you more graciously, Lord, for answering the prayers that we bring before you. You are an amazing God and an incredible God. Happy are those whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sin is covered. It is Jesus Christ who brings life and makes us righteous. Let us pray. Song, hymn 70. Please stand. A little bit on the testimonies, and I'm going to ask if there's something in the upper rooms that you read this week that touched your heart. You care to share?
Ecclesiastics.
Yep. There's a time for everything under the sun. Anybody else? I have a couple things that I want to bring up this morning, and they're not in... It's a little bit different, okay? A couple weeks ago, I asked you to read James 5. And I don't know if any of you read James 5, but one day we'll talk about James 5 because it's important. We always want to know how the Lord talks to us. And some of us really don't understand that. We heard the voice of the Lord and we go, we didn't really hear a voice. But this last week, the Lord gave me another scripture. And I believe it pertains to America fully and strongly. And it's found in Isaiah. And it goes in Isaiah 12 through 18. And so I want to read that this morning, but I'm going to talk a little bit of inserts in that also. We have heard in this land of conspiracies all over. We have heard conspiracies ever since an election began. So it starts out, "For the Lord spoke thus to me with a strong hand and instructed me that I should not walk in the way of this people, saying, do not say a conspiracy concerning all that this people call a conspiracy, nor be afraid of their hearts or their threats, nor be troubled. the Lord of hosts, him you shall hallow. Let him be your fear. Let him be your dread. He will be a sanctuary, but a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense to both houses of Israel. I take that both houses are talking actually about the both houses of our government, the House, the Senate, and the representatives. This is actually talking about America. As a trap and a snare to the inhabitants of Jerusalem, or the inhabitants of America, they have been a trap and a snare to us. Both houses, not just one, but both. And many among them shall stumble, and they shall fall and be broken, be snared and be taken. Bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples, and I will wait on the Lord, who hides his face from the house of America. And I will hope in him. Here am I, and the children whom the Lord has given me. We are for signs and wonders in America from the Lord of hosts who dwells in Mount Zion. What I understand in this, that the Lord will take care of what he will take care of. And we are to watch and we are to wait, but we're not to complain. We are to praise and we are to worship, because God says he will deal with that in his time. But we are the signs and the wonders in America. The body of Christ is the one that will bring anything back to America. Not our politicians and not the government, but only Christ and his disciples that will call upon the Lord God to restore. I heard this week something that I thought was so amazing. There's two nations that God has blessed. The one nation he created is a nation, Israel, to love him. To love him with all of their heart. And he has found that very difficult, because Israel has walked away from him for as long as they were created. They have walked away. And the other nation is America. And why is it America? Because America was built. The people that came here came to worship freely the Lord God Almighty. They already loved the Lord when they stepped foot on this land. They came to be free and to love the Lord God Almighty. So the Lord is not done with America. He is not done. I believe there will be the latter rain, where there will be people that God will bless, and I believe a revival will come amongst the people of God, and it will spread mightily, because God loves this nation, because we love him. It's not all of us, but there's enough of us to make a powerful statement that God is the one. And it's amazing to watch God when he works, because when he's done and his works are mighty, even those that do not believe in God will know that it was a hand of God that is moving. So I truly believe that God has given this message to us, not just to me, but to us, to encourage us to pray for America, that it will be a blessing and a glory to the Lord God Almighty. So, anybody else got a testimony they want to share this morning? All right. Amen. Just remember, with God, there's no coincidences. There's no coincidence. It's by plan and by purpose. So this morning in our scripture, we're going to the temptation. We find Jesus going out to the Jordan. So I'm just going to read the first part. Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, returned from the Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. One verse, twice, that mentions the Holy Spirit, that he was full of the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Spirit leads. And the Holy Spirit actually leads our lives even when we're not really sure about that. But let's talk about temptation. There was a gentleman, and he had a dog, and he wanted to train his dog. So the dog was kind of new, but he had had him for a while. And the gentleman would lay a piece of meat on the ground, and the dog would come up to eat the meat. And every time he come up, he would hit the dog with his cane, and the dog would grab it. And he did that over and over again. He would lay the meat on the ground. He would call the dog. The dog would see him lay the meat on the ground. And he was so anxious to get the meat, he would come up. And again, his master would hit him with his cane. And it went on and on until finally, when the dog came up and he laid the meat on the ground, the dog would not touch it. But the dog would not look at the meat either. The dog would look directly at the master to see what the master was doing. It has to do with temptation. The more we look at temptation, that's what drags us in. The more we think about something that we want to do that we shouldn't do, the more we concentrate about doing that, it drags us in. We need to keep our eyes on Jesus Christ in order to be holy and true. It's an amazing story. I thought it was really cruel of the master to hit the dog. But it's a lesson that is well taught. There's nothing wrong with temptation. The problem is when we answer that temptation. And so we'll see today how Jesus dealt with the temptation. And he had the whole weight of the world upon his shoulders. He wasn't, we're just common, ordinary people. We don't carry the world, but he does. So full of the Holy Spirit, and he needed to be full of the Holy Spirit, and he needed the Holy Spirit to lead him. He went into the wilderness, a dry, barren, hostile place for anybody to be in, where for 40 days he was tempted by the devil. Remember that. He was there for 40 days. For 40 days he was tempted by the devil. I have read this before, over and over, and oh sure, he was there for 40 days and never thought much of it. And then we get to the three temptations. But he tempted him the whole time he was there. And as he was there for 40 days, he was tempted by the devil. He ate nothing during those days, and he was famished. And the devil said to him, "If you are the Son of God, command this stone to become a loaf of bread." If you are, he's asking the Lord Jesus Christ, if you really are the Son of God, you have power and you have authority. You can just take this stone and make it into a piece of bread. You know, it's not tough for you to do that. And God really wouldn't care. You can about imagine what he said to Eve that for, what did God say? And he's doing the same thing with Christ. Are you really sure that you're the Son of God? And if you are, prove it. If you are, you can prove it to me. You know, I'm the only one here. Nobody else will see. Just prove it to me. And Jesus says to him, and he answers him, "It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from God." His eyes stayed upon the Lord God. He knew what God was, and he knew that's where his source of power was. Because in ourselves, we are too weak. We have to call on the name of God when we're tempted. Because we want it. We want it. Jesus wanted that bread. He was famished. He was starving. But he could not do that because it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth from the mouth of God. The devil led him up and showed him in an instant all the kingdoms of the world. You can have everything. God gave it to me. It's all mine. You can have everything that you see, all the kingdoms of the world. They'll be yours. You still have power and authority. You can do whatever you want with them. And it'll be marvelous and glorious that you will be the King of Kings, that you will rule. You can have them. They are yours. I will give them to whoever I please. But therefore, then you shall worship me, and it'll be yours. That's quite a thing to ask the Lord Jesus, isn't it? That instead of worshiping Almighty God, he's worshiping the devil, and Jesus knows who the devil is. He knows that he was an angel that was kicked out of heaven, that himself wanted to be God. And his answer is, again, get behind me, Satan. Simple, easy. Get behind me, Satan. For it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and him only serve. And it's found in Deuteronomy. So Jesus gives him what is written in the scriptures already, which is an amazing thing, because they've been put down by scribes all the way through, and Jesus knows every word that is in there. But he's not, the devil is still not done yet. He's still not done. Then the devil took him to Jerusalem and placed him on a pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, if you are the Son of God, again we come with if you are the Son of God, then throw yourself down from here. For it is written he will command his angels concerning to protect you, and into their hands they will bear you up, so that you do not dash your foot against the stone. Isn't it amazing now how this gets turned around? Now Satan is quoting scripture to Jesus Christ. If it is written that, you know, their angels will all gather around, just throw yourself off the pinnacle. It's only 450 feet. It's not that big a deal. You know, besides that, they'll all be down there gathering, waiting for you, so you won't hit the ground at all. He's pretty clever, isn't he? You have strength to do this. I mean, it's only one step off. And he looks. And Jesus answered him, it is said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. Do we test the Lord God? Do we say, if you will do this for me, I will do that? Do we bow down and worship other things other than the Lord God? Our world creates idols all over the place. And do we have our own idols also that we worship? But our word comes back to looking into the word to find out what is written, to beat the enemy, to beat Satan, that he does not tempt, he can tempt, but we have to answer him with an answer. No, I belong to the Lord God Almighty. Get behind me. You have no place in my heart. If we look around at our world today, you can see that the enemy is alive and well. all over. How do we answer back to that? What do we say to that? God tells us to love the Lord. He tells we're to love the Lord with all our heart, with all our mind, with our soul. And we are to love people as we love ourselves. And we struggle with loving people. And so we must ask the Lord to help us to love others that we, even in our own minds sometimes, have already put down that they are unlovable. We have to stretch further than that. The two houses in America, the Senate and the representatives, and all the rest of them, we need to pray for them that God will touch their hearts, that God will open their eyes to show them exactly what Satan is doing with their lives. When we say yes to Satan, the only thing that can possibly follow is destruction. Our world is in such a way it has a hard time even knowing truth anymore. Knowing what is right and knowing what is wrong. Because we have followed after Satan in so many different ways. But God gives us the power to say, it is written, serve the Lord God alone. He is the one that is, every word of his gives us life and truth. It gives us joy and gladness. It gives us a will and a backbone. Because we're not doing it by ourselves. We are doing it. We are doing it fully with God. He is the one that calls us out. He is the one that blesses us. So Satan has been tempting 40 days. He's been there badgering. Badgering the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only was he hungry, he was battle-worn. Can you imagine Satan being around for 40 days and offering you absolutely everything in the whole world and beyond? And yet he said, do not put the Lord your God to the test. His words are powerful. They are mighty. After all this, Jesus rejected him over and over again. When the devil had finished every temptation, and we have no idea how many that was, when he had finished every temptation, he departed from him until an opportune time. It didn't say he quit, does it? No, not at all. We see him raise his head up over and over again in the life of Jesus Christ. The 33 years upon the earth, the devil was at his heels all the time. And he fought because of what? Because of who we are. We are his. He knew the price was tough that he was going to pay. He could have glory and majesty. Instead, he chose suffering and the cross that we might live in the name of Christ, that our sins are forgiven in the name of Christ, that we really have life, joyful life, in the name of Jesus Christ. We have some time left here yet. Some time in this place that we are living, we have time to call upon the name of the Lord and worship him and praise him and ask him to strengthen us, to tell others of how much God truly loves them and how amazing he is and how you love him. The greatest story you can tell to somebody else that will convince them is your love for the Lord, as to why you love him, why you trust him. Because your story is nobody can tell your story but you. of how God has walked with you, how God has slammed some doors on temptations that we had a difficult time, but God has taken them away. That we can trust Him to lead us. Like the little dog, keep your eyes on the Master. He doesn't use a cane. He uses love. But keep your eyes on Him, because that will help us walk through any temptation that's out there. And for that, we thank Him. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, You have bestowed upon us victory and glory and honor through Your Son, Jesus Christ. You have called us by name because of Your Son, Jesus Christ. You have blessed us over and over again because of Him. And because You are the Lord God Almighty, we bow in our hearts before You and yield, Lord. We yield to You to use us as You will, to use us mightily to raise the name of Christ here in this place, in our families, and whomever we meet, that we are a blessing to You and a joy. For this we thank You. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. I would ask you to please turn in your hymnals to 526. What a friend we have in Jesus. And it's probably on the board also. Thank you. Please be seated. At this time, is there any joys and concerns that we have this morning? What was his first name?
Bruce.
I got Ruth. Yeah. Is he the one that was injured before? Okay. Anybody else this morning? James?
My dad's sister, Penny.
Penny, okay. All right.
Chris, thanks for Bill.
Yeah. Cool. I have a praise the Lord for my sister Pat, who's been in a nursing home. She lost Marvin not too long ago, but she is coming around in the nursing home. She can have visitors now and everything. And one of the things, I don't think I shared with this, they wanted to know, they kept finding her walking in the hallway or out in the hallway. And they wondering how she was getting out there and how she could get up and walk. And she was walking by herself, actually. And so they get up, and there she was out there. Nobody put her out there except she did. So they finally asked her, how do you get out there? Well, I get myself into the wheelchair. And when I get into the wheelchair, then I wheel myself out there. And I get hold of the rail, the handrail along the side of the aisle that you're supposed to help just as you're guiding it, and I pull myself up with that. And then she walks behind the wheelchair. And it's amazing to see that, because it's been a hard time for her to walk. So, yeah, I think, and because she can have visitors now, so it's a good thing. So praise the Lord. So, anything else this morning?
Continue prayers for Scott. Your Pat?
Oh, Pat. She has another surgery, or she had?
She'll have her surgery on the 15th.
Okay. Okay. Anything else this morning?
Okay.
Yes.
One of the people that worked with my company, David Hossie, that we heard about him, he was ended up getting shot in the garage.
Oh.
And he passed away. And it's an errant bullet. They don't know where it came from. But it leaves behind a 17-year-old daughter and a 6-year-old son. I'd like to put them on our list. And then another person that I work with, his dad has like a form of, it's a shaking disease.
Parkinson?
But it's different than that, but it's like that.
Okay.
And his wife is his caregiver. She could really use, because he just got diagnosed with another thing, fibrosis of the lungs, and it's there's only one way.
Yeah.
And they're gonna need some
major
support.
Yeah. Cool.
If we could add Sharon and Wally, that's her name.
Okay.
That would be good. Sometimes you feel guilty isn't the right word, but things are really going good for me.
Yeah.
Still people suffer.
Yeah.
So it's hard to be joyful about your things when you know others.
Yeah. Yep.
Yes.
It is. It's hard to see that. So, and I praise the Lord that Donnie goes to a doctor again on Wednesday. We'll kind of give him an estimate of what's going on with that. So he did ask the physical therapist not to beat him up so bad when he's in there, so then he can't walk for 2 days. So he did lay off a little bit on that. So he is doing much better. The swelling is going down, and so... So praise the Lord. Anything else this morning?
No, I got one.
Okay, Izzy.
Okay, so I just wanted to pray for the Brooks family and have them be in God's care.
Okay. Okay. One of these days I'm going to ask somebody out there if they want to say a prayer instead of me doing all of this, because we need the body of Christ to pray, so... pray with me this morning. So, okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, there are so many things out there, so many people that we love and care for. And we just, in our mind, Lord, we bring them before you. But this morning, there are things still upon our hearts that we want to bring together as the body of Christ in one accord and in unity. Even though we do not know what the others are praying about, we still bring it before you, Lord, in unity. I remember when the disciples were together in unity and one accord. And there's power in that when we pray with one another. And so we'll take a moment now of silent prayer, but it'll be silent, but we will be together as the body of Christ. Hear our prayers, O Lord. Father, I lift up to you the body of Christ this morning. Not in this place, but around the world, Lord. Those that are facing persecution, those that their lives are costing them because they are followers of you, O Lord. They will not deny you. They hold your name high. We just lift them up, Lord, that you will continue to have your abundant of love around them and your care there, Lord. And we ask also, Lord, that you will soften the heart of the enemy, that they too will become to see that Jesus Christ truly is the Lord of all. You have a way of changing hearts that are rock hard into soft and pliable. So we pray for the enemy, Lord. We pray that you will reach down and touch, and it might not be all, but those that yield will be soldiers in your army, O Lord God. For that we thank you. We pray for Bruce Natlin, O Lord. We ask your comfort there, Lord, and your peace there, O Lord, that you would surround him and just touch him in your healing touch in the name of Christ. We pray for Penny, Lord, and you know all about Penny. You know that she can be a blessing, O Lord God. And we ask, Lord, that you will bless her, that you will bless her mightily, that you will just help her in her heart and her mind, that she will see you, that your presence will surround her, and she will know that she is in the presence of Jesus Christ, and there is healing there. We thank you, O Lord, for watching over Bill and for Donnie, O Lord. We just thank you that they are here worshiping again with us. And we thank you and praise, O Lord. We ask, O Lord God, that you will give Pat a sweet, calm assurance that you are there. That you will give every doctor that is there and every nurse that is there that they will do everything correctly. That you will give them even more wisdom than they really do have, but it'll be wisdom from you, O Lord. And that Pat will also witness to them her love of Christ as she is there and where her faith sits when she is there. And they will just do their very best. But Lord Jesus, you are the best. And so we ask your healing touch to be upon her, O Lord. We pray for the Fosse family, Lord, who is going through many, many things, and the children, O Lord. 17 and a 6, Lord. We ask that your presence be in that household. We ask that the comfort go to Mr. Fosse, Lord, that you will calm within him his spirit, that you will give his wife strength and encouragement and a joy within to be the helpmate that you created her to be, the helpmate in your eyes, O Lord, that she will be one that helps her husband through this time and shares her joy with him as they both cling together and they both come together with their family. Lord, bless them and bless them mightily, O Lord God. And we praise for the Burke family, Lord. And we lift them before you. We ask that you will continue to guide and direct, that you'll continue to bless and to nurture, and that your presence will be there. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And now, O Lord, as you have taught us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And not next week, the following week, we will begin with communion again. And we will at that time also start anointing with oil during the worship service. So just be aware of that. All right. Now, with that, it is time for our gifts and our offerings. And I have a praise the Lord, I'm not attached to a wire. The widow's mite, you counted as great. Lord, we give of ourselves unto you. By the works of our hands, O Lord, we give to you. By the songs that are in our heart that we sing to you, we give to you. We give to you when we lift our praise up to you and bow before you. We thank you, Lord, for all that we have given you, you have given us. And we give back to you. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you. Our last song for the day, Leaning on His Everlasting Arms, 133. Go in the grace and peace and the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. And always look into the Word of God. It is written. That is your ammunition that you take with you. It is written. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and rejoice in Him. In the blessed name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Hallelujah and amen. God bless.